accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Michelle Long, it's 9 noon in Manila, 10 noon in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines. Wall Street suffers another sell-off as bond yields continue to rise. Asian shares set for a mixed lower open. The PSE index outperformed on Tuesday, climbing back above 7,300 despite persistent foreign selling. We speak with Sue Trin of Manulife Investment Management for an outlook on Asian markets. Microsoft bets big on gaming as it buys video game maker Activision Blizzard for $68 billion. And COVID cases in Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon exceed the peak of last year's Delta variant surge. Global investment banker Stephen Konyang will weigh in on how the Omicron surge is affecting the Philippine economy and other things moving the market. Begin with the financial markets, a sell-off on Wall Street overnight as bond yields continued their ascent and Goldman Sachs reported disappointing fourth quarter earnings results. The Nasdaq took the biggest hit, plunging 2.6% on Tuesday as tech stocks declined, continuing their downward trend in 2022. The Dow also losing 543 points, while the S&P 500 closed at 4577. Now, on the earnings front, Goldman Sachs missed quarterly profit expectations. The bank's quarterly profit fell 13% year on year to $3.94 billion or $10.81 per share. Goldman's fourth quarter revenue also falling 7% to just over $12 billion compared to the previous quarter. The Wall Street giant's compensation expenses soared 33% last year, contributing to the decline in the bottom line. Goldman shares dropped 7% following its earnings report. Meanwhile, benchmark U.S. Treasury yields jumping to two-year highs and two-year yields breaching 1% as traders prepared for the Federal Reserve to be more aggressive in tackling hot inflation.
I kind of started to realize that the only way the market was going to start to sell off and people were going to, you know, the euphoria was going to come out of the market was rising interest rates, right? Something had to fundamentally change. And that's what we're seeing, right? We are seeing now people trying to figure out, trying to jockey around how they're going to rebalance their portfolios, knowing that going forward that we're going to have higher interest rates and that we're going to have a tapering and that the sugar bowl or whatever you want to call it is getting pulled away.
Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, seems like a muted open there when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. In corporate news, Microsoft is buying Activision Blizzard for a whopping $68 billion in cash. That deal would help the Xbox maker become the third largest gaming company by revenue. Microsoft has been making big investments in gaming, scooping up Minecraft maker Mojang Studio and ZeniMax in multi-billion dollar deals in recent years. Activision's library of games, which includes Call of Duty, gives Microsoft's Xbox gaming platform an edge over Sony's PlayStation, which has for years enjoyed a more steady stream of exclusive games.
Activision has a lot of intellectual property and a lot of businesses that are developed that Microsoft hasn't yet actually engaged in, like mobile, like free-to-play, without having to buy anything. I don't think that the share price is particularly good or bad for anybody. It's a fair price. I mean, Microsoft's paying about 10 bucks lower than the all-time high. Tech has melted down. So Activision investors are getting back most of what they lost, and I just don't see another bidder, so this price seems fair.
Microsoft dipped 2.4% after announcing that news, while shares of Activision Blizzard surged nearly 26%. Now, still in the U.S., Verizon and AT&T will temporarily limit their 5G services around some airports due to interference issues. Verizon is still set for a 5G launch on Wednesday, but it did acknowledge some crucial operational issues have yet to be resolved. AT&T, meanwhile, agreed to defer turning on some towers around runways. The moves come after major U.S. airlines warned this week's 5G rollout could ground some planes and cause chaos for flights. As for the White House, it hopes the two sides will still be able to resolve the issues.
Tomorrow is the deadline. Our objective is, of course, to reach a solution around 5G deployment that maintains the highest level of safety while minimizing disruptions to passenger travel. That's what we're working towards.
U.S. aviation authorities earlier warned potential interference due to the 5G deployment could affect sensitive aircraft instruments that are crucial for making landings and poor visibility and for helicopters flying at low altitude. Back here at home, the Philippine Central Bank says online fraud costs consumers around 540 million pesos last year. Now, this has raised the pressure on Congress to pass a final or financial protection law. Sherian Torres with the full story.
Rose, not her real name, received a call from a supposed bank officer last April claiming that her bank accounts are being hacked. She was advised to immediately change her password. Rose, who was used to talking to her bank's branch manager using a mobile number, immediately trusted the caller. She also gave her one-time PIN or OTP.
Alam niya na agad yung profession ko, lahat. Nadidictate niya. So, napaniwala ako kasi ba't alam niya yung personal information ko. Kahit nga username ko alam niya, hindi ko agad na-realize yun na dapat talaga hindi ko binigay yung OTP. Kaya lang nabigay ko na yung OTP ko sa tumawag. So yun na, nag-proceed na po lahat ng transaction. Feeling ko hindi ako na-protektahan.
Rose was asked to wait for a call the next day for a new password, which did not come. She later found a total of 900,000 pesos illegally withdrawn from her account. Rose was able to recover 330,000 pesos after her bank was able to trace the fraudster who attempted to again withdraw from her account. Bank Fraud PH, an organization helping digital fraud victims, underscores the victims' difficulty to recover their stolen money. Bank Fraud President Richard Law says the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, which is supposed to protect the banking public, can only refer the complaint to the bank.
We group them together, then we ask BSP, can you at least mediate group sila? BSP is saying they cannot do that. BSP and PC cannot do anything because they're going to say they can only mediate. But it's a referral system. So referral system, they're just going to say to the bank na you take care of this.
The Banco Central admits they have no power to resolve digital fraud complaints, which from 2019 to 2021 totaled to 42,456 cases amounting to 2 billion pesos in losses. In 2021, hackers were able to rake in around 540 million pesos from thousands of digital consumers, according to BSP Governor Benjamin Chokno. Given these limitations, financial regulators extended their appeal to the Senate to immediately approve the Financial Consumer Protection Act that will grant them quasi-judicial powers in handling bank fraud cases without the need for any court intervention.
Hackers and scammers took advantage of the digital infrastructure and consumer vulnerability to perpetrate crime. These cases could be resolved quickly once the FCP Act is in place. This act will empower financial regulators such as BSP, the Insurance Commission, the SEC, and the Cooperative Development Authority to expedite the adjudication of reasonable monetary claims more efficiently, fairly, and openly, all to the benefit of the consumers.
Senators say they will try to enact the measure before 18th Congress ends. Bank Fraud PH urges bank depositors to place their savings in either current account or time deposit, since any attempt to touch their money would require bank checking and days of clearance. The BSP, on the other hand, reminds the public to exercise cybersecurity hygiene. These include ignoring emails, texts, or calls asking for one's personal information because financial institutions would not ask for sensitive details. Consumers are also urged to use legitimate mobile banking apps, avoid using public Wi-Fi when using e-banking websites, and activation of multi-factor authentication in all banking activities. Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today. Wednesday, the United Kingdom will post its December inflation print. Consumer prices in the UK rose to 5.1% in November. Now, it was the highest rate since September 2011 due to rising energy prices, supply chain disruptions, and a low base effect from last year. Canada will also come out with its inflation figures for December of 2021. Canada's headline inflation rate remained at 4.7% in November. Now, together with October, it was the highest reading since February of 2003, with the strongest pressure coming from transportation underpinned by gasoline prices. And the Eurozone will report its November construction output. Construction output in the euro area rose 4.4% in October, the strongest rate of growth since May, as both building activity and civil engineering works expanded faster. A UN agency says tourism arrivals around the world are not expected to return to their pre-pandemic levels until at least 2024. The World Tourism Organization cited the highly contagious Omicron variant for the dim outlook. It says while the variant causes mild symptoms, it will disrupt recovery in early 2022 as global travel restrictions were again imposed to curb its spread. It adds the pace of recovery in the tourism industry remains slow and uneven due to varying degrees of vaccination rates and traveler confidence. Vaccine inequity highlighted at the 2022 World Economic Forum. The World Health Organization pointed out only 7% of the African population has received two doses of COVID-19 vaccines. In comparison, over half of the world's total population has already been double vaccinated. The director of Africa's Disease Control Center also expressed his anger and disappointment over the matter.
Study after study, including our studies, are showing that 80% of the populations are ready to take vaccines if the vaccines are available. So what we have seen over the last 2 years is really total collapse of global cooperation and solidarity, period. I think there is absolutely no reason why a continent of Africa should be lagging behind with having 7% of the population fully immunized. A continent of 1.2 billion people is totally unacceptable.
Gavi, a vaccine alliance which co-manages COVAX, is seeking more funds to reach the WHO's goal of vaccinating 70% of the population in poorer nations by July. Hello. Back here at home, COVID-19 booster shots will soon be administered in select drugstores in Metro Manila as the government continues to ramp up its inoculation campaign. Now, this will begin towards the end of the week. Dr. Ted Urbosa, medical advisor of the Interagency Task Force, says the move aims to ease pressure on vaccination sites manned by local government units.
It became evident that we needed the help of the boticas when several of the local vaccination sites started to slow down, especially during this Omicron surge. The personnel in the vaccination sites were getting quarantined or isolated because they were testing positive. So that led to having a negotiations and training. So we started to train the pharmacists and the personnel.
Authorities arrest two men selling fake paracetamol in Quezon City. Our correspondent Jackie Pascual joins us on the line for more details. Jackie?
Good morning, Mimi. Two individuals have been arrested for reportedly selling fake medicines in Quezon City. The chief of the Metro Manila Police, Brigadier General Vicente Danao Jr., says an entrapment operation was conducted by the police and the Food and Drugs Administration, wherein two men were caught selling allegedly fake medicines in Barangay Holy Spirit. Over 100 boxes of medicines, mostly for fever, colds, and cough, have been recovered. This includes several boxes of paracetamol, which saw higher demand in previous weeks. The medicines, which all have markings of popular brands, have a total value of over 109,000 pesos. Police are investigating if there is a bigger group behind this illegal activity and where the medicines are made. Initial investigation shows the fake medicines came from overseas. The police are now urging the public to just buy medicines from legitimate pharmacies or drug stores to ensure the efficacy of the medicine and the safety of the public. Mimi, back to you.
Thank you for that update, Judge Pascual. Do keep safe out there. Now, moving on to more news, the Philippines logged over 28,000 new COVID cases on Tuesday. Now, that's lower compared to the tally for previous days because fewer tests were conducted over the weekend. Active cases eased slightly to 284,000, while the positivity rate stands at 43.4%. That is the lowest since January 5th. COVID cases in Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon Island have now exceeded the peak of last year's Delta variant surge. The health department is also seeing a worrying trend in other regions, but it says it's still not sure whether the Omicron variant is driving the spike in fresh infections there.
Meron din po tayo na nakikita na high-risk case classification, actually critical sa Region 2 po. And then the rest of the other regions ay nasa high risk na. Pag tinignan po natin ngayon ang trends ng mga ibang rehiyon dito po sa pagtaas ng kaso, nakikita po natin yung steep increase in the number of cases dito rin po sa ibang rehiyon. Hindi po natin pwedeng masabi definitely or with certainty that this is really Omicron. But based from our experience here in NCR, we are seeing the same trends in the other regions. But of course, this has to be proven by the whole genome sequencing also.
The Philippine Justice Department insists government's no vaccine, no right policy is not discriminatory. Justice Secretary Menardo Guevara says unvaccinated persons are still allowed to travel, but have only been restricted access to public transportation. He says it is within the government's power to implement such rule for the interest of public safety. Guevara also emphasized the policy is time-bound and may be repealed as soon as cases go down in the Capitol. The Justice Secretary, however, admits implementing the policy to its full extent may be problematic. Metro Manila's public transport ban on the unvaccinated not to be applied on workers. Labor Secretary Sylvester Bellio made this clarification on day two of the implementation of the controversial policy. He says workers will only need to show their company IDs to enforcers.
Exempted po ang mga workers natin because they are rendering essential services. Pagtingin po mo mga yan, paano gagalaw ang ating mga negosyo? Pag walang negosyo, walang ekonomiya.
Secretary Bellio proposes a massive information drive to ensure implementing agencies know about the exemptions. Also exempted from the policy are unvaccinated persons buying essential goods, seeking medical treatment, or going to a COVID vaccination center. Now, the overnight sell-off on Wall Street extends here in Asia this morning as a surge in Treasury yields and the prospect of Federal Reserve monetary tightening to fight high inflation weigh on market sentiment. Japan's Nikkei 225 declining in the region, down 1.5%. The drop there was also triggered by news that Japan is seeking to tighten restrictions in Tokyo and a dozen prefectures to contain the spread of the Omicron variant. Now, shares in Australia and South Korea are also in the red. Meanwhile, Australian household sentiment dropped this month as an ongoing COVID surge there worsened existing supply chain problems and prompted shoppers to turn more cautious. Westpac says the Consumer Confidence Index fell 2% to 102.2 points in January. We're also monitoring Toyota shares after the world's largest automaker said it will no longer meet its target of producing 9 million cars this year due to persistent chips shortage. Now, joining us today for her take on Asian markets, Sue Trinh of Manulife Investment Management. Hi, Sue. Thanks so much for joining us and Happy New Year.
Hi, Michelle. Happy New Year to you, too. Thanks for having me back.
All right. So let's start with a big picture. You know, between expectations of a more aggressive Fed tightening and liftoff as early as this March, and you've got South Korea going ahead with its third hike since summer, and the Bank of Japan yesterday standing pat while raising inflation outlook, how are you now approaching rates? And what does this all mean for risky assets? Are you still risk on or risk off investment strategy?
Well, the emergence of the Omicron variant has really increased uncertainty, but we continue to see its impact across the Asian region as very uneven. So some of the factors that play into that unevenness and how it will affect various economies, vaccines, access to those vaccines, the rollout, caseloads, proclivity of governments to lock down, as well as that reliance on services, reliance on net exports to drive growth, just to name a few. And of course, as you mentioned, we have to throw on top of that the prospect of much more aggressive Federal Reserve tightening than even the market expected 3 months ago. Within the region, the upshot is, however, that policy normalization will be slower and of lower magnitude than most other parts of the world. And one of the saving graces for Asia is its trade surpluses, which helps to keep inflation relatively more benign, a much weaker pent-up demand. Of course, it's the manufacturing hub, and so access to the supply that the rest of the world really wants much easier, of course.
Mm-hmm. So could you walk us through, Sue, your call on Asian markets? I mean, where are you overweight, where are you underweight, and where are you neutral?
Well, when we screen for growth and inflation regimes in terms of what the market is expecting this year, the Asia scorecard is really quite a mixed bag. So macro stories that we think are a lot stronger than the rest, Taiwan and Vietnam stand out. These economies are already above their long-term GDP trend. For Taiwan, GDP is likely to be boosted by the consumption recovery and steady support from investment. Think about FDI flows here. For Vietnam, similar story there, and activity has resumed much faster than expected following the extensive factory lockdowns that plagued the economy in the third third quarter. On top of that, fiscal is very supportive as well, with a recent package approved worth around 5.5% of GDP. Now, in terms of other economies, Singapore and Malaysia are starting at below trend GDP, but they both have very strong potential to recoup a lot of that lost output. So Singapore, much more or much faster vaccine and booster rollout there, enabling a much more calibrated reopening. Malaysia also accelerated vaccination trends there. Government spending is helping too.
And what about the Philippines? How does the risk reward profile look like for the Philippine markets? Are you seeing the Philippines as more a value play that's ripe for some re-rating down the road?
Obviously, really important story for your audience there. Philippines has been hit very hard by the pandemic. It has been a consistent laggard in terms of where it sits in GDP versus trend. There's a lot of work to do. And of course, you know, with the economic recovery lagging the region, we're expecting it to take some time yet before Philippines is anywhere close to recouping a lot of that lost output or closing that output gap. You've got the national elections this year, of course, taking place in May. That could provide some support to domestic demand, but it remains to be seen given that we're moving to an online platform there relative to previous cycles. So perhaps that fiscal impulse won't be necessarily as strong. And of course, household consumption, however, really great potential there given how what a strong share of GDP it is for the Philippines. But it is going to be held back, unfortunately, for a little while yet on the back of the pandemic and also low vaccination rates.
Mm-hmm. But Sue, when you think about investing, the goal for every investor is to get in before everybody else does. Stay ahead of everybody. Do you think now is the time to get into the Philippines, considering we're lagging behind, our valuations are cheap? Because of that, is today the time to get in before prices rise again?
Of course, it's entirely dependent on your investment horizon. For those shorter term outlook, it may be a little premature. Or if you have a much longer range horizon in mind, then by all means, it does suggest to me that now could be a good time with that longer range perspective in mind. So entirely dependent on your risk profile.
Okay. Now, looking at the next 11 months, where do you see the best value in terms of asset classes? Is it still equities? Are bonds starting to look a little bit more attractive? What about treasuries or cryptocurrencies, perhaps the alternative investment vehicles? I mean, when you look at Omicron and the potential for new waves, where do you want to be invested in for the next 11 months?
For the next 11 months, really a lot, so much hinges on what the Federal Reserve does. We were discussing earlier, it's a very aggressive profile that's been baked in the cake here. Now, the problem that we envisage is that a lot of the inflation that is spooking central banks around the world, including the Fed, is that it's driven by supply shortages. We're not seeing the demand lifting concurrently. What I'm alluding to here is potentially stagflationary conditions, of which central banks are very hard-pressed to address. It's a real policy dilemma, damned if you do and damned if you don't, but it looks like the Fed is pressing ahead nonetheless, and that risks nipping any nascent recovery in the bud on the demand side. We worry that there will be a policy pivot later on this year, possibly the second half, that could well usher in potentially better outlook, at least on a sequential basis for risk assets. But for the first half of this year, it could be somewhat challenging.
Mm-hmm. And finally, the Davos Agenda virtual event running this week. It's offering the first global platform of 2022 for world leaders to come together and share their vision ahead. Is there anything investors should be paying special attention to?
As usual, the Davos event, if you look at the mindset of those participating, at least on the main stage there, no doubt we'll see pro-capitalism, pro-democracy, pro-globalization push there. The key to me really is the global growth outlook. What is the IMF going to roll out? And from that perspective, there is a risk that we're seeing a sequential markdown in terms of their global growth forecast, which would be in line with what we're expecting, slower growth relative to the very reflationary environment that the whole world enjoyed for most of 2021.
All right. On that note, Sue, thank you so much for joining us today. Have a great week ahead.
Thanks, Michelle.
All right, we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, we speak with global investment banker Stephen Kuo Yang for his take on how the Omicron variant and the upcoming 2022 polls here at home can sway financial markets. Market Edge will be right back.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Market Edge, the headlines. Wall Street suffers another sell-off as bond yields continue to rise. Asian shares dropping at the open. Kirito and the PSE index outperformed on Tuesday, climbing back above 7,300 despite persistent foreign selling. It opened in the red at 7,304. Microsoft betting big on gaming as it buys video game maker Activision Blizzard for a whopping $68 billion. And COVID cases in Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon exceeding the peak of last year's Delta variant surge. Global investment banker Stephen Konyang will weigh in on how the Omicron surge is affecting the Philippine economy and other things that may move the market. Quick look now at the Philippine Stock Exchange. The main index opening in the red. We're 3 minutes into trade for the day. We're now at 7,304, down 0.5% from Tuesday's close of 7,343. It has since widened those losses and is now trading below 7,300. Meantime, here's a rundown of interesting corporate stories from this morning. Manila Jockey is selling 1.9 billion pesos worth of properties located in Santa Cruz, Manila to Mega World. Mega World, of course, is very heavy in investments in the Binondo side. So this is going to be sort of an expansion in Manila and in Metro Manila. Also, Medilines, among the newest members of the exchange, which debuted late last year, renewing their contract as a distributor for Siemens Healthineers. Looking at the auto side, Toyota cutting production by 20% in February due to chip shortage. Now, this is not just here in the Philippines, but their global operations. We do know that Toyota already saying that they're not going to be meeting their 9 million car production target for this year because of chips shortage. We're also looking at some feel-good stories from San Miguel Corporation. They're looking to remove 1 million tons of silt and solid waste from the Tulyahan-Tinajedos River system by June of this year. This is part of their 1 billion peso river cleanup project. And banking side now, amended charter of Veterans Bank will now allow post-World War II veterans to be shareholders, which means AFP retirees can finally own shares of the bank. Capitalization will be increased to 10 billion pesos from just 100 million. All right, it's that time of the month again where we get our daily, our dose rather, of Stephenomics. Today, global investment banker Stephen Konyang will weigh in on Omicron, the May elections, and hopefully when we have time later on, shipping. Stevie, happy new year and welcome back.
Well, thank you for inviting me again. New year, new virus, old politics, old disease. But anyway, let's see what we can do.
Okay, so let's start with Omicron, the big news that exploded at the start of this year. America's top doctor, Anthony Fauci, Stevie, identified the five phases of a pandemic. The first one is the truly pandemic phase where the whole world is negatively impacted. Then you've got the deceleration of the pandemic. Then you've got control, when you have it present, but at a level that doesn't disrupt. Then you've got elimination. You don't have it in your country, but it's out there. Pretty much like polio, which is not in the US, but present in other countries. And then you've got eradication, the dream, the goal, which is sadly only true for just one infectious disease, and that is smallpox. When we talk about the shift to endemic, what do you think is the market pricing in? What is the realistic expectation here? Do you think 2022 is the year when COVID shifts from pandemic to endemicity?
Simple answer, yes. And I would like to point viewers to a New York Times article that first was published, I think, in May, but then they republished it last December. And it said, how do pandemics end? And they said there are two ways it ends. One is medically, when it's eliminated. The other one is a social end, when people say, enough, we can deal with this. It's not that it goes away. It's that it no longer becomes debilitating. Now, they don't just wake up one day and said, I'm tired of this. I'm going to live with it. No, certain things happen, like in this case, vaccines, a level of herd immunity, knowledge on how to deal with it, and so on. But even though it's not completely eliminated, they basically say we have sufficient tools and means and knowledge to deal with it, so that it becomes something we live with, not something we fear and shut things down from. So the people believe we're actually at that stage already in certain countries. Like, I'm in New York right now. I'll be in New York for another month, more or less. I've watched 3 NBA games live. I've watched an opera, the Metropolitan Opera. I've watched a concert. I eat out indoors. Why are people so blasé about it, even though there are cases? Because they are seeing that single digits of the cases in hospitals are from the unvaccinated, or sorry, to use the exact term they use in the US, the not fully vaccinated. Because what they mean is you either have 2 doses, or if you're 2 doses plus a certain amount of time, you're boosted. All right. So that's what they determine as fully vaccinated. And they're basically saying the worst scenario is if you're fully vaccinated, you might get a cold or be ill for 3 to 5 days, which is like if you got the flu, not everybody who gets a flu shot doesn't get the flu, but almost everybody who gets the flu shot doesn't die or doesn't get hospitalized. And they're saying with very few cases, even the people who are vaccinated, who are hospitalized, most of them went to the hospital for something else. And when they were tested, found out they had asymptomatic or very mild symptoms. So technically, they didn't even have to be hospitalized for COVID. Mm-hmm. They were hospitalized for something else. So now what's happening is basically people are acting like what Macron, which is they're dividing now between what the world will be for those who are fully vaccinated and what the world will be for those who aren't. And the brunt, at least if you take out the noisy, let's say very right-wing and extremist views, everybody's saying, let's just live a normal life if you're fully vaccinated. And the restrictions will be for the unvaccinated or the non-fully vaccinated. And you're seeing that already. You cannot go to a restaurant in New York unless you're fully vaccinated. Mm-hmm. Not, you know, out there, you cannot, period. You cannot go to a movie house. You cannot go to a gym. You cannot go to a concert. You cannot go to sports unless you're fully vaccinated. So now you want to stay in your home and do pickup, then fine, stay unvaccinated. So that's why the society is now saying we are already acting like it is endemic because it mm-hmm. is endemic for the people who are fully vaccinated.
Mm-hmm. Stevie, I'm very curious. While life appears to have returned to normal there, what's the mood of the people, of Americans? When you see cases hitting 1 million, for example, per day,
I mean, it's a psychological thing.
Because here we're hitting 30,000, above 30,000 for how many days, except for yesterday. And people are saying that's conservative because many aren't even doing RT-PCR tests anymore.
And Fauci and other people have said we're probably only catching 10%.
Yeah.
Okay, of who's really infected now. But I don't want to say this is the mood of the country. I just want to say this is the mood of New York City. Because New York City is 80%+ vaccinated, honestly, they don't care. I mean, they're basically saying you're dumb enough to be the 20%, then that's your problem. But if you're the 80%, they don't care. I mean, I go to the gym, I wear a mask. Okay, now, you don't have to wear a mask outdoors. I still do. I would say about 50% of the people in the street wear a mask. So 50% don't care. They're willing to be outdoors because they said it doesn't really spread unless you're face-to-face for an extended period to somebody outdoors. In the gym, 3/4 are not wearing a mask inside the gym, which I think is crazy. But I mean, this is blue state. This is New York City, high vaccinations. So I don't want to extrapolate to the rest of the country. But the mood is we're post-pandemic.
Is the market post-pandemic, Stevie?
Well, if you listen to it, yes, because Moderna's price is dropping because they're thinking the demand. See, because the purest play, if you want to play vaccine, is Moderna because Johnson, it's a sub. Pfizer, it's a sub. Moderna has only one product, the vaccine. It's gone down like 60% from its peak. That tells you what people think. Okay. Planet Fitness is moving up. That's a nationwide gym, they have gyms nationwide. They're moving up and Moderna's moving down. So now, stock market's going down for other reasons. It's basically interest rates and so on. But as far as tech stocks are also went down the last few weeks. Why? Because they're saying the fueling of work from home, all the tech enabled, like they're basically saying in a few weeks, maybe in a few months, if you still invite me, I might be in your studio already rather than doing this via Zoom if I can. So basically that's what they're saying. So they're saying we will still not go back to where we were before. Mm-hmm. But the exponential growth we were seeing in the use of Teams, in the use of Zoom, in the use of Google Meet is going to taper off. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it no longer deserves the valuations where they were expecting doubling of use year on year. Mm-hmm. Now to be 20%, 30%, whatever. Still very good, but more in tune with a high growth company rather than an explosive growth company. Mm-hmm.
Stevie, you made mention of how the big story now is still inflation, the Federal Reserve tightening. Let's talk about that. And let's link it to the Biden story, because President Joe Biden marks his first full year in office tomorrow, that's Thursday, and his ratings are less than stellar. Would you say that Fed Chair Powell is to blame for that, for failing to deal with hot inflation that's hurting the average American right smack in the middle of a pandemic, hurting the ratings of Mr. Biden?
Well, I would try to be, again, as balanced and fair as I can try to be. If he did preemptively raise interest rates last year, mm-hmm. then he would have had the same results now. I think the truth is, it turns out Larry Summers was correct and Paul Krugman was wrong, right? That's a given. So Summers has been making his victory laps every week on Bloomberg. And Krugman has been justifying why he's not really wrong in the New York Times. But so the problem really was, how long were these bottlenecks going to last? And that's the problem. Right, that's why shipping costs are up, containers up. And the problem was, because we now have global supply chain, Omicron affected the easing of these bottlenecks and normalization. I mean, look at Hong Kong, where now they're saying you can't even do cargo flights anymore of Cathay because they've added. So bottlenecks because they're no longer just between the factory and the consumer or the wholesaler, you now have global supply chain and every bottleneck affects everything. Like, you realize last year, for the first time in, I suppose, a century, General Motors was not the highest selling car brand in the US. Guess who it was? Toyota. First time in US history, the number one selling car brand is not an American company. Now, they expect GM to be number one again this year, but it was not lack of demand. It was lack of supply. They had not handled the computer chips needed to finish the cars. So Toyota was able to ship and assemble more products, and they actually outsold General Motors in 2021. And that's kind of, but again, nobody's panicking because they think it's temporary. They don't think, oh, forever Toyota's going to outsell General Motors in the US, but they actually outsold them last year. First time ever a non-American manufacturer sold more cars.
So when you look at the inflation story, Powell's not to blame?
Well, I mean, I don't want to say Powell's not to blame. In my view, it was a reasonable bet to make. Let me at least not decide this way or that way until we see if the bottlenecks are sustained or not. And it seems to be sustained. Now, if you look at the, listen to Summer, she said, I told you so, and now you're not good. It's not very easy to have a soft landing. So we'll see. But I don't think you can fault him, given it was literally a half full, half empty situation where, I mean, look, you've got a Nobel Prize winner, Paul Krugman, who's been correct in his analysis after the 2008 recession up to now. You've got Larry Summers, who's a very reasonable and awarded economist. Both are centrist left, both are Democrats, both are very respected and multi-awarded. They completely disagree. What does that tell you? It really was a 55-45 decision for both.
Yeah.
So you can't really tell someone who was saying, I don't know where I'm going to land. Let me wait for more evidence before I decide. Now, to Powell's credit, at least when it was sustained, he did move decisively after. I gave him that much credit.
Stevie, I'm very curious. In your many years as an investment banker, who would you say is your favorite central banker?
My ex-boss, because he had to do it in face of a recession, political uncertainty, and an administration he was not part of. So that would be good. In the U.S., I honestly think Greenspan was overrated. It was good. And he was, frankly, more political than people like the cred. So I don't want to say, I mean, like, maybe Ben Bernanke had to deal with the 2008 recession. And frankly, it hurt the U.S., but it didn't hurt more. But again, I want to say the difference between 2008 and today is you had a relatively responsible legislature and executive doing things. They argued on the margin, but they didn't argue in the concept. Well, right now in the U.S., you have basically two parties who are evenly balanced, who are basically not talking to each other. It's also easier to be a good central bank governor when you've got a responsible fiscal regime, you don't really have right now.
Okay, we're going to leave it at that. Stevie, let's bring the conversation back home. Another big market risk for the Philippines would be the upcoming presidential elections happening in May. And it looks like it's coming down to a Bongbong Marcos-Lenny Robredo showdown. What are the chances? Are you expecting any surprises to be pulled off? Strategies differ between a Bongbong regime and a Lenny leadership?
A very serious senior banker at Evercore told me something when he said, who's going to win? He said, the favorites don't always win, but it's the way to bet. All right. So if we're saying that, I'm not saying the result is certain, but you cannot ignore what's going to happen and what it's pointing to. On that basis, I think a lot of the things people take for granted may not be taken for granted anymore. For example, all constitutions are written as a reaction to something. The U.S. Constitution was written in a reaction to being a colony of the UK, of England, and the absolute monarch. So that's why you have division between the executive and legislative branches, because in the UK, they're fused. The prime minister is also the head of the government, and he's the head of the legislative body. You have that divided in an American system where you have the presidential system. So the U.S. Constitution is written basically as a revolutionary constitution to fight the system imposed by the U.K. Now, so the 1973 Constitution was basically a reaction to martial law, and it was the way Marcos wanted the Constitution to be. The 1987 Constitution was a reaction to that. Now, if Marcos is going to win, he has no loyalty to that constitution. So there will probably be amendments. finally, where will the amendments be? Political? Will they be economic? I don't know. But I would say, if you looked at Aquino's regime, he had extreme loyalty to the Constitution because it was done during his mother's time.
Mm-hmm.
This is who was it in reaction to? And now if they're in charge, who are they going to react against?
Mm-hmm. So, but for investors, will it matter who wins, Stevie?
Again,
or are there structural things that...
Look, I don't believe in structural... We don't have strong structures and institutions in this country. I'm sorry. I wish we did. We don't. Mm-hmm. People thought when Estrada took over from Ramos that certain reforms were very well embedded and everything was going to be fine. Guess what? It wasn't. All right. I think, frankly, our institutions are driven by the person on top. It's not very set in practice and respected. That's my personal view. You can disagree with me. So therefore, who is president is very relevant. What his view is, how decisive he is, especially given whoever becomes president, everybody joins his coalition after in Congress and the Senate. Right? The president has so much power that he never has a recalcitrant Senate or Congress. The only opposition people, I bet you half of them, are the people who want to join but are not allowed to. Winning coalition. Right? I mean, honestly, because there's no ideological difference. It's all patronage. Now, so what the president wants to do and his mandate to do it is very important. So what I'm going to say is, does it matter? Yes, it will matter. Will it be good or bad? I don't know. I don't know how whoever will win in May, although one can assume it will be the leader if he maintains his lead, but obviously change is always possible. But how he's going to approach it, I don't know. Because unfortunately, we don't really, which is one of my themes, I don't know if we have time to discuss it, where I wish there was a agreement or consensus on certain issues which transcend politics. But in this country, it doesn't.
Issues like what?
Okay, let's start.
Very quickly, we have 1 minute left.
Okay, infrastructure. Do you want more infrastructure or do you want to raise money? Privatization, you basically are trying to sell something you don't want to keep for a high price. Building new infrastructure, you want the most utility for the cheapest price, correct? Because people will be using it forever. So why do we have all these bids for toll roads where there's the amount you're going to give the government first? It helps raise revenue, which we need. But who's paying for it? The people using the toll road and everything for the next 30 years because it's baked into the return. Well, if they didn't have to pay that upfront fee, you'd be riding the roads for cheaper. Because what all they've done is the lump sum payment is amortized over the life of the concession. If you didn't have the lump sum payment, there's less to charge and the owner will still make the same return because he doesn't have to pay X percent. He didn't have to pay X percent of the concession, which he's recovering over 25 or 30 years or whatever the term is from the users. Now, what do you want to do then? Do you want to maximize revenue or do you want to maximize utility, efficiency, and cost? It's time to have a debate on that and reach an agreement what to do. Because why are we losing to Vietnam? We have power that's 40% higher than Indonesia, 20-25% higher. Power is 50% of heavy industry cost. Are we going to have a policy that we're going to make power as cheap as possible without subsidies, or it's whatever the cost is? I mean, we can talk about that next month. Anyway, budget election.
We should.
So, yeah, and then same thing with education. We have deprioritized educational quality as seen in the spending. We are seeing engineers, first of all, what are we training? We're training blue collar workers at the expense of having which we need to do, but are we training engineers, the people who will get high quality jobs and industry moving, or not? As I said, three clients of mine who are thinking of opening their second production in the Philippines or move to Vietnam. They said the engineers are actually better there. And they're not even talking about the graduates of the best schools in Vietnam. Another one is simple, last one, agriculture. You have people saying we need to concentrate on lowering the cost of goods. Other people saying we need to protect the livelihood of the farmers and have food security. You know, it's one thing to be in New Zealand where there's more sheep than people. You can afford, no, seriously. So you're sparsely populated. You can rely on imports and exports and everything. If you are over 100 million people, do you want to rely on imports or do you need food security? Japan subsidizes its rice farmers and everything because they want food security at a cost. I'm not saying I'm not an agricultural economist. I don't know what the correct answer is. But these are fundamental questions that need to be, we need to reach a dominant view on and stick to. Because you have this mix of issues. You have agriculture where some people say you want the price of onion and rice and everything to be cheap. But at the same time, we're saying, oh, but farmers are going out of business. What's it going to be?
Okay. Stevie, unfortunately, I don't have the answer to, but we'll definitely spend more time talking about these questions when we talk again next month for Stevenomics.
On these consensus issues, industrialization, agriculture, costs of infrastructure, education, you might want to invite people who are experts. And I'd be curious what their views are. I do not claim to be an expert on any of that. I just know they are important issues.
And they're important questions to be asked. Thank you so much, Stevie. Always a pleasure. Never enough time with you. We'll see you again next month.
See you next month. Thanks again. Bye.
All right. And that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.